Well, the last time we talked was Life in a Day, and of course that was, you know, we were really left alone on that film. I mean, we were just given carte blanche. I mean, Google never asked for any changes or anything. I mean, it was glorious. Audience is the best notes you can get, really, aren't they?
Yeah.
You know, when you sit in front of a screen, those are the best notes.
You find out in a hurry.
You smell. You can smell it. You know, it's unmistakable.
Yes. You're now married to Denis, partially. Is that one of your new? Do you have multiple? Are you polygamist of editing polygamist?
It's like a kind of. It is getting a bit wife swappy. I did earlier in the year. I did a short art film with Steve back in Amsterdam, Steve McQueen, and it did feel like I'd come through one door in a bedroom fast and shut it quickly behind me. I'm engaged with Denny for a couple of films, and Steve's been doing some other things, so it was kind of good timing. And we'd done three solid films together, and it felt, I'd settled in Los Angeles, so it just, it was good, good fortune.
Do you have a max in terms of the number of things you'll want to do in a year? I mean, you kind of
I wish sometimes you could do more than one film at a time, but you can't. I mean, it's impossible for me to do that. I mean, I know there are composers who develop huge empires and oversee, and somebody else is kind of, there's an army, but it doesn't really work. I find it even hard to give an assistant something to edit. I feel I have to kind of apply the clay myself.
Because it's just the way it works for you personally? Or, I mean, do you see other editors who have that kind of...
Yes, I've seen more collegiate. I've worked in a more collegiate environment with two other editors on Black Hat and All Hands to Deck kind of thing. But to me, it's came up from that sort of belief of screening rushes in the morning. That's when I started on film, and it was so it's ingrained in me that you really pay attention in those screenings, and you try and learn the dailies, and you learn where everything is, and you. In the back of your mind, you know where to find those different ways of going. And also, it's a chance to look at dailies and respond to them and say, if I respond to it, then I think everybody will.
Are dailies the same as they were 10 years ago?
Well, that's the trouble. You see, with Roger on Sicario, it was fantastic because they shot single camera. So I was getting an hour and a half, and that's totally manageable to do that and cut it in a day.
Right.
Black Hat, I was getting 3.5-4 hours, and that's totally unmanageable. You can't, you can't see everything and cut it in a day. It's impossible as a first pass.
But do you have time with a director on these days, the way things are working, or... are you just now getting DVDs, or how do you process them?
90% of the time they're put up on an online forum that you can. I mean, I'd sometimes hear the email going at about 11 o'clock at night, and I'd think, okay, a reel or two's gone up, and I'd sit and watch them as soon as they came in. So it's not like screening used to be, but
not that long ago.
Not that long ago.
A few years ago, you used to go every that morning, and you found that hour and. Yeah, sat in the room together.
Sat in the room together, which is so important. And you find out, you really find out what people want, what they're looking for, and, correct. You can make corrections,
So are you of the editing group that shows up with a, first cut the day the film's over and hand it to the director and then start working from there, or?
Here's your film.
Well, that seems to be a thing now where editors are on set and they're, by the time the movie's over, like within a week, there's a first cut that's not necessarily for the studio.
Yeah, the first assembly is pretty, I've spent a lot of time on it. And actually parts of Sicario, I've got to tell you, are the same as the first assembly. I mean, that's kind of quite flattering. I won't tell you which bits, but there are a couple of scenes in there that are the same as they always were. And Denny just rang me and said he was dancing when he saw it, and he doesn't want to change it. And he was true to his word.
So is that because of Denny? Is that because of what he shot, or the
I think Denny and Roger on this
focus on
very. I mean, they're meticulous planners, and I think it's also to do with the budget. I mean, 30, 31 million. which is a lot of money to some, but for this film, you know, with the location changes and a lot of action, it's not that much. And so they didn't want to waste anything. There was nothing really on the cutting room floor. Mm-hmm. I get a spare shot or two. So really my job was to subvert. I mean, rather than surrender to these masters, it was to sort of say, you know, there's a different way of doing this and sort of trying to kind of go, you know, hello.
So are you able, did you find you were able to do that?
Yeah, in a couple of places. Yeah, I think I found some things. But Denny, they're very clear. I mean, Denny's so clever. He's, you know, I think it's my idea, but actually it was his. So he just sort of hypnotized me with some thought bomb, you know. And, I don't know, he's Master McQueen, you know, but the two of them, I mean, they storyboard very carefully. They spend a long time storyboarding and, you know, it just means, and Rogers, every shot has to earn its place. And so it's very, you know, it's super specific. And then it just enables me to be very, very rhythmic about what I'm doing. And because everything's going to work, of course it's going to work, but it's like, it left me to really fine tune it.
So is Michael Mann like, cutting a documentary? I mean, you're getting so much footage that you're just trying to figure out which way is up.
Well, I mean, Michael is extraordinary as well. He'd be up all night giving you notes on the dailies, and they would be, you know, take 17 past 34 or past 37 or take 11. You know, he has, within a take, there's many goes sometimes of a line. And he'll just zone in on one little thing, but he'll also look at a three-camera shoot and look at each camera separately, which is something a lot of directors don't do. They'll give notes for one master camera, and whereas Michael responds to each camera separately. And, you know, there's a certain poetry, even if it's the same reading of a line, there's a certain poetry on one camera position that he likes more than the other. And he'll, you know, so he's a super detailed, as you probably know, he's a super detailed director in that regard.
So is that unlike anybody else you really work with, or is that...
Yeah, Denny's much more, he doesn't sort of specify the steps. He's not didactic in any way. He'll just sort of give me a, you know, really good thought. I mean, here's a typical one. In Sicario, there's a scene where Kate goes back to her flat and she forces herself to look at images of the violence in Mexico. And there's just a shot which is going slowly in towards the screen. And one of the little adaptions that we made in the cut was Denis had had this idea that instead of it going towards the images of violence, it goes towards the forward button. So as you slowly go through, it says much more about her determination to force herself to keep her eyes open and look at this stuff because she has to get on top of it. And also, in some way, I think it says something about how these images just become normal and peripheral. It's a very strong direction, you know, in a cut to make those kind of choices.
So do you have both of those choices in front of you, or do you just have the finger going to the button?
No, I had one shot and I subverted the frame.
Within the frame?
Yeah, and there was other examples of that, like, for example, the surveillance footage outside the bank. You could do a very neat, you know, we had the individual frames and I knitted them together and did these sort of continuous passes, diagonal, but not, you know, it's hard to describe, but rather than starting and stopping, starting and stopping, it's just kind of constantly moving across, and it gave it a style with the drone footage of things constantly being surveyed, you know.
Was there, I mean, when you started back in the day, was a lot of this kind of ideas like doing things like that, was that much harder to do it?
Well, waiting for an optical to turn up, yeah, for sure. The first experience I had, which was really flattening for me, because I came from a music and composing background, and you were restricted to chinagraph marks on the film for dissolves, and you just literally get them back from the lab and you go, it doesn't look anything like what I imagine. It's like, it feels 12 frames shorter than I expected. And sound, you know, from a composer background, you had a choice of two tracks. So, you know, if you had something with music and voiceover and sync, you'd have to lose one of those elements and put it on a little roll and put a rubber band around it and put it on the shelf and wait for somebody to remember that 6 months later. Yes, you know, the compromise was horrible. I mean, there's no romance to cutting film, I don't think.
So you were over that?
So over
early
it.
On.
Yeah.
no fighting to go sit and get your moviola back in the...
No. I did like... I miss light going through film. That is a beautiful thing.
Yes.
day in, day out.
Well, it's romantic. I mean, there is a romantic thing about actual film.
And the smell of the cans.
Yeah.
That's actually, that's not always a good thing. There was a, I'd worked once as a sound editor, and I worked, one of my assistants had a really bad BO problem, and we were stuck in these little rooms. And I remember it was intoxicating. I mean, it was, and I did actually have a word with him one time. And unfortunately, all that happened is the next day he turned up and he had Brute. You know, this horrible.
it was
the smell of the BO and the Brute.
That's a lovely combination.
And then when I came back to the cutting room about 6 months later, I remember opening a can and it was that smell.
God. Anyway,
yeah.
He was there with you.
It's better than a plaque on the wall, I suppose.
But there is something about like looking around the floor for, you know, for short ends. Things for little frames that are missing.
Yeah, normally on the director's shoe.
Yeah, there was something, but there was something cool about that, even though it's ridiculous when you think about it.
Well, you know, and I work with some editors who are sort of, they would say, I need a shot that long, you know, and they'd put, that's how long, and you'd put it in the film, you go, absolutely, I get it, it's whatever it is, 3 seconds, you know. Mm-hmm. But I learned a lot. I mean, I had a really good teacher. I mean, I came up through the BBC and I did the apprenticeship and worked on a lot of things, and I had some really great teachers. And the good thing as well was that you could learn cutting because, you know, you'd have a steam beck and typically you'd have a steam beck and a flatbed in one corner of the room and you'd have pick sinks, you know, or competitors where you could gang a couple of soundtracks together. And it meant that if you put headphones on, the two of you could work in one room. So if you were really up against it as an editor, you'd give your assistant, somebody like me, a chance to sort of have a go at cutting something and it wouldn't interrupt your, you wouldn't have to stop work. Whereas now, of course, it's like, you know, there's so much that needs to be done technologically in the background that sometimes it's very hard to give assistants some work to do like that.
So it seems like the fact that you can control more of it once it's all set up, it suggests that you should.
Yeah.
For you. I mean, that you have, like, having your fingers in all the, on all the buttons.
Yeah, it's going to make me sound like a terrible control freak, but it just feels like I don't know, I just feel that I have to have a one-to-one relationship with it. I mean, I've recently been giving more sequences to assistants to cut and had some really good results. In fact, there was a very funny, we had a day on Sicario where something got cancelled. We had a day and I had Javier, who's my long-term assistant, who's something of a VFX master. He did so much work on Sicario, you know, temp things. We'd cook up an idea in the next room. And, you know, for example, in the night vision sequence, we were sort of saying it would be really cool if we could have some drone shots from above. And we lost the geography a little bit at one point. And it felt like we could have that, the team, the outside team, you know, voices present, which I thought would be really good. So he'd knock things up and turn helicopter shots into drone pilot shots. And we'd record little voice things and, you know, try and make it very rhythmic and sound effectsy. And Mary, who was our second assistant then, we had this day when we had nothing to do. And I said, well, why don't we take the Oscars and import it? And just there was a rather awkward moment where somebody corpsed on stage. And why don't we have a competition to see how awkward we could make that moment? So what was amusing about it is I went down in the kind of sound route. I had this sort of Penderecki started at some point as this person just sort of froze. And then a man comes and stands in his underpants, but nobody's saying anything or applauding. And then a Lego character came out and started saying, everything is awesome, but I slowed it right down. But as soon as I started it, I realized I need like 3 days. I'm just not going to get this done in a day. And then Javier...
This could be an Oscar-nominated short.
It really
like.
Should. We should put it on YouTube. And Javier did this marvelous thing with a sort of psychedelic background shift. So the guy was sort of where he was, but everything in the background, so it was an acid trip. And Mary, and he again sort of realised he needed like a week to do it justice. Whereas Mary did this really great one where she just made it longer and more awkward and finished the assignment. And that was when I realised that she was quite a good team, you know. At least she's going to make sure we get it done. You
Everybody
know?
Brings a different, their different energy.
Yeah, indeed.
So, I mean, it's interesting because you're talking about losing geography. It seems like you, with your three directors of this moment, you have Steve where... The geography seems like it's almost never an issue because he really is intimately with the characters at all times. You have Denis, who is somewhere in the middle and does these big shots, but a lot of intimate shots. And then you have Michael, where it seems like you might have to fight for geography in every scene, like where it's a challenge because there's so much going on in his work.
I mean, Vive la Défense. I mean, that's the thing. I mean, Denis, I'm very comfortable with that sort of way of making movies, I suppose, that middle ground. I mean, Steve, sometimes, you know, they both make choices that I benefit from in a way, you know, of holding back sometimes. And, you know, Steve particularly, you know, is well known for those long shots. And but they all present challenges not so much, you know, to do with pacing. I mean, it's, you know, it's not, I think I've heard people talk about the kind of slow editing style, and it's not to do with being slow, I don't think. I think it's to do with pace and to do with compressing time so that you're allowed to kind of breathe. And in a case of Sicario, I think a strong element of it is that there's violence around the corner right from the beginning of the film. You know that this film can surprise you and give you jolts. So a shot where you hold for a long time and you go down that hill into the darkness is very, very tense, you know. They all have their own sort of aspects. With Michael, I doubt if I could have persuaded him to hold a long shot, even when I had an option. But that was a different kind of film, and it was just, you know, that wasn't the right style.
He makes a different kind of film. I mean, he's a different...
Completely,
And Denis is, you know, probably the guy, in terms of doing the kind of broader pieces. I mean, Steve hasn't really done an action movie, as it were. But, you know, Denis... The lengths to which he will go with a single shot, or a few cuts in a sequence, is kind of remarkable when you watch his work.
Yeah, kind of, I mean, there's an intensity to the, you know, it's managing that tension, isn't it?
Yeah.
And I mean, someone like Benicio as well. I mean, he's mad and he hypnotizes you as an editor. It's almost impossible to cut to anybody else.
He does eat it. It's amazing.
He really eats it, and he says so little. So it's kind of very, I don't know, it's funny. It's a calculation of tension, isn't it? Tension and time.
Yeah, we shot Benicio recently for this movie, and Emily, and Jess Chastain, and they were all like talking about how, you know, on the set, it's like, Benicio, open your eyes, or they're actually on red carpets, Benicio, open your eyes,
eyes. It's true.
But that's, he just is who he, you know, that's his thing, but it's so powerful.
Yeah.
It is kind of just, even just him in the background is...
We did a terrible thing though. We dropped a scene in the cut, which was, the film used to start with Benicio, and a wonderful thing that they shot in Veracruz, where he's drowning somebody, and well, it starts with a guy in evening suit, you know, Alejandro in an evening suit, and he's standing waist deep in water in the ocean, and he's drowning. This policeman, and yanks his head out of the water. He asks him a question, the guy doesn't answer, so he shoves him back in, but he goes too far and drowns him. So he takes, you know, the guy dies, so he pulls him back to the shore, gives him CPR, kiss of life. He comes around, coughs and splutters, and he just starts interviewing him again. It was a brilliant opening scene, but we hit the cutting room floor.
What kind of gives away the mystery, I guess?
Well, the film is about viewpoints, you know, for a large part of the film, it's Kate's viewpoint and she's behind, you know, catching up. She's on catch up. She's trying to work out what these guys intend. And I think sort of seeing Alejandro through her eyes when he comes into the plane and follow, you know, her trying to penetrate that armor is the fun of it. If you know already that he's a hitman or, a torturer, then it takes away the progression.
Which he points out right away, by the way.
Exactly.
The conversation with him, he's like, you know, the movie's named after me. He doesn't say it quite like that. But he goes, as I'm playing the Sicario.
Yeah.
So is keeping her, I mean, I guess when I first saw the picture, I've seen it a couple of times since, and it's evolved for me. But, you know, what my earliest concern about the movie was that she was a little bit too much of a victim for me. Was that a challenge to keep her from being, you know, too innocent, too...
Yeah, well, I think it's a problem of passivity. You know, she's a supine character. I mean, in fact, in a way, you know, we had a similar editing challenge with 12 Years a Slave. You know, that Solomon is, you know, it happens to him, and there is, you know, you run a risk because that's not a very cinematic thing. You know, cinema heroes change the world, save the world. You know, and there is that element in commercial cinema that requires that, and there's some frustration I can remember somebody once saying that, you know, Solomon reminded them of Barack Obama, you know, in some ways, mm-hmm. some frustrations that they felt towards him.
Yeah.
And so it was kind of carefully tuning, you know, their aggression and sometimes it's a simple thing that, you know, you instead of showing some, you know, Kate and then what she sees and then her reaction to it, then you either go into the thing mm-hmm. or you come out of the thing. You don't do both.
Right.
Or, you know, or sometimes you let things happen by themselves. So it's a little bit, so otherwise, you know, she could end up looking like, you know, the Queen Mother being driven through Juarez. You know, you could easily cut it and it would look like a royal parade.
Yeah.
Very sick one. But, you know, that's just a fine-tuning thing, isn't it? And sort of carefully managing the moments where she protests and making the most of those.
Well, Josh is also kind of an interesting, because in some ways he's leading them into this. But because Benicio's character is so strong, he kind of becomes more the flavor, more the, you know, spice in it than he is the center of it.
I don't know if the right word is sarcasm, but I always found that was the, you know, there was some is kind of sarcastic view of imperialism, isn't it? Mm. And Josh Schimpf seems to love the chaos that he creates.
Yes.
And I really love the idea that he probably goes home to his kids and, you know, plays and has a beer and then, you know, gets cool and then goes out.
Well, he's rationalized it all to himself to the point where he's, you know, a true believer that he's right, always.
But he still goes from the guy in the flip-flops at the beginning to what looks like the devil at the end, I think.
Yeah. Well, the movie's saying that. I'm not sure he changes.
Our view of him as we see more.
Yeah, the movie knows things. So what was it like? This completely off of, down
let's
on
go,
the deep
let's
end.
Go there.
What was it like when you started seeing the footage from... Hunger. Yeah.
Oh, my Lord.
Because that was your first, Steve's first movie. Your first movie is Steve.
Yes.
And certainly the most extreme of his films. And, you know, and fascinating in terms of editing, I think.
Yeah, the first thing, I think, one of the first things I saw was a shit wall. It was like somebody, you know, dowsing a wall covered in shit. I don't know, I was so excited about that film. I remember, you know, I was so excited. I mean, partly my own background, I come from a, you know, Catholic family and, you know, brought up to believe that the IRA were a great evil in the world. And, you know, my parents were not supporters at all. And, you know, they did many mainland attacks. And they also, I think, as Catholics, saw them not as freedom fighters, but as suicide, you know. Mm. Which was abhorrent to them. So it was kind of really kind of, I was very glad to see the 180 degree shift in my view and, you know, to see the other side. But no, it was so bold the way the dailies came in and, you know, the planned, you know, 21, I don't even know, it's a 21 minute sequence or something. Just everything about it was just felt like very, very fresh and new. And there was no way of telling with Steve beforehand because I knew his name very well, but he hadn't made any conventional films. So it was nothing, no DVDs that I could get. We just literally had to sit and talk about the subject and you know, go around the houses. So I just remember tremendous, yeah, it just felt like a super fresh talent, really super fresh. And I was in Belfast and I really, you know, it was just me and the dailies and he didn't shoot too much. So I was like a pig amongst the acorns.
Did you guys just figure it out quickly? Was it a natural connection?
We also come from the same part of London. We both grew up in Ealing. It's a suburb of London, leafy suburb, and Ealing Studios is there. And we went to the same parks and the same library and the same cinema and, you know, from slightly different areas, but nevertheless, it had a lot in common.
So as the relationship matures, from movie to movie to movie, with somebody like that, does it become less and less conversation or more just about the overall subject and less about the specific cutting? Or
I think there's total trust, isn't there? That's what you develop on the second film, hopefully. And, you know, certainly with Denny, I'm finding that, you know, that there is a shorthand and, you know, we've worked together successfully. We don't have to apologize so much for our daft ideas, you know, and we just sort of explore them and find a rhythm together. Yeah, and certainly with Steve, yes, conversation stays the same, but it's like, it's just from a very much more relaxed position.
What seems like in some ways Steve, like, made the rep that would make Denis go, I got to get that guy, this cutter, because there's something he understands. He gets the joke. He's not going to fight me and try to make it a conventional.
Well, the best directors are like that, though, aren't they? And we're talking about two of the best directors on the planet at the moment. They're both, you know, experts at whipping up enthusiasm, but, you know, fanning the fires of creativity, mm-hmm. wherever that may be, you know, and having bold style and confidence in what, you know, is that's they're both guilty of that.
So at this point, are you do you audition your potential directors that are coming up the way that they
I'm used not
to?
That so I may be British, but I'm not that grand.
But I mean, do you think, oh, you know, it'd be fun to work with do a light comedy next time? Or?
Yeah, I keep telling Steve we should do. I really want to do a musical. And, that's really not happening. But
Shitwall the musical, I think, would be fantastic.
Shit Spiral, that's what it was called. I remember in the script, a Shit Spiral. No, I mean, Denny came out of that thing of a conversation with my agent and saying, you know, who do you want to work with next? And I'd seen Encendie, which I recommend to everyone. It's a brilliant film. And then Prisoners, I saw with my daughter, and we were both just, you know, our hearts were pounding out of our chest. And
how old is your daughter?
She was, I watched that with her when she was 17. So,
okay, that's 17.
Yeah, yeah. She was, yeah.
You just don't
enough.
Look like you'd have a 17-year-old daughter. Huh?
I've got a 22-year-old. So, yeah, you should see the painting upstairs in my attic.
But so, you saw the movie and you were...
I saw the movie and I just thought, I would love, that this guy, I'd love to work with him. And the tension I felt in that film. And I'm so glad that people find that in Sicario because... You know, I'd be so disappointed in myself if I'd edited a Denis film that didn't end up with the same kind of breathlessness that you feel at the end of Sicario. So, yeah, no, it felt like a really good marriage, and Steve was between projects, so it just was a perfect thing. And I just said, can you get me in the room? And, you know, so it's not auditioning, really, directors, right. But obviously it's a, you know, chance to kind of, you know, 12 years has definitely opened doors for me to be able to kind of... you know, people recognize my work, thank God.
And if you want, and when you do get footage, the same kind of question about Deakins, when you get his footage, you started by talking about it actually on your own. It seems like there's a very definitive thing. He's, you know, very specific. There's not a lot of, you know, playing around or trying to figure things out. But are there other things you see in his shooting that make him Deakins, quote unquote? Big capital. Letters.
Well, I mean, I love that. I always loved that shot of Benicio coming towards us with a water bottle. That always felt like a kind of, you know, has a brilliant move, which is perfectly timed. The height of it is just right, and the swagger of the actor is perfectly captured. And I think it's a yellow wall, so the blue sticks out. It's got a real kick to it. And there's a sort of, you know, dark, slightly comic feel to it. You know, we know what's going to happen. So I don't know, that felt like a very sort of Deakins moment. I mean, I suppose there's an element of Coen Brothers, you know, there's an amalgam there, isn't there?
Yeah.
I don't know, I think he's just, he's a genius.
Would you rank, I mean, do you, when you you see the footage through, not through your Steinbeck, but as you're looking at the footage and you're seeing what the actors are doing, I mean, do you have a hierarchy of who's the better actor, the great, you know, what the special things are about each actor? I'm not asking you to expose anybody, but
no.
Do you, you know, can you go, oh, that guy's, I got to fix that guy. I got to, you know, I can let her float. I can.
Yeah. I mean, it's a dance. The editors dance with the actors all day long. And you know that because if you're doing a fight sequence, your muscles are tense at the end of the day. And it's a sign that you're sort of becoming one with what they're doing rhythmically in a way, I think. But I mean, there's some, you know, I mean, how could I feel like that? I mean, I sort of like Daniel, for example, in this film. He just is amazing. I mean, that's on the page, it's not a rewarding part. He's the guy that the main person talks to. Mm-hmm. You know, we've seen that many, many times in scripts, but he totally inhabits it as Reggie. Mm-hmm. And there was a brilliant piece of improvisation between him and Emily Blunt. I mean, so no matter what the sort of status in terms of the running, you know, the billing order, it's... surprises from everywhere, and I don't know. This, I don't think I've had to cover anything up for a long time.
It's been a while.
Yeah, it's been a while.
Because you're working with such high-end actors, I guess, who really know what they're doing.
Yeah, and you know, I mean, I've spent a lot of time looking at people like Michael Fassbender, and, you know, I'm slightly spoiled, aren't I?
And what do you think? Do you have a theory about what it is about Michael Fassbender?
Because I wish you could bottle it. It's very hard to know what exactly it is. I mean, he's got no breaks as an actor, which I really love. You know, it feels like there's no, you know, nothing off limits. There's no vanity. Maybe that's what it is. It doesn't feel like there's any vanity going on there. He just wants to present the character.
Because it's fascinating just to, over and over to watch him. And I saw Macbeth the other night, and obviously Steve Jobs, and he's you know, I can't quite figure out how he got from one to the other. You know, it's not like Olivier, where there was a certain Olivier thing, or, you know, that old style of acting.
Yes.
It's not, it doesn't feel methody, really.
No, and with Steve Jobs as well, it's a strange part with almost no sexual power to it as well, which is an odd thing for Michael. There's normally a very charismatic sexual persona there.
Yeah.
And I found Steve Jobs very fascinating to watch, not to have that.
Well, they kind of take away Kate's sexual power in that also.
Yes.
So it's an interesting thing, these two beautiful people. You know, you're like, in another movie, they'd be a romantic couple.
Yeah.
And here they're this kind of incredibly non-romantic.
Yeah.
But very intimate.
Yes.
Thing going on.
Yeah, that's exactly what it was.
Yeah. So, are you enjoying another round of this part of it, where you get to go around and be poked at and...
Yeah.
tell your life story?
Yeah. Yeah, dredge the anecdotes. Yeah, no, it's very... I mean, I'm a little removed from it at the moment, because I'm in Montreal. I'm working with... Denis on the next film, which is a science fiction film with Amy Adams. We're very intensely in that. So I'm literally coming back home for like a weekend and sort of packing it in and then sort of going back and very removed.
Amy's very hard to cut also.
Oh my God, it's a nightmare.
Well, you know, it's funny. She's so, there's this kind of like new maturity to her in the last few films that she really is very proud of, I think.
Yeah.
And she understands, but it's like, it's fascinating to watch this kind of evolution happen.
Yeah, it's also, you know, she's just enormously generous and giving in this, you know, a lot of it is looking at a green screen and it's a real test of an actor, isn't it? You know, if they can... The funny thing with those green screens, it's not normally just a green screen. It's sometimes a man in a little suit of blue or green holding, you know, a pole with a tennis ball on it. It's to be able to kind of emote with that in front of you is a major test.
Well, now she's learned how to do it with Superman, so now she can go do it like in a more more dramatic way.
Yeah.
As opposed to just tights.
Nobody wants to be in those spandex tights. They're not flattering, I can tell you. But no, it's an honour to cut her. And Jeremy Renner as well, and Forest Whitaker. So it's kind of really great faces to look at.
Whitaker is a guy who just doesn't seem to want to, you know, he doesn't want any part of this part of it. But he gives these performances where, like in Southpaw, he's just breathtaking. It's like in maybe 10 minutes of the movie, and you're like, just kind of blows you away every time he's on screen.
Yeah, I just love looking at his face daily. It's a wonderful thing to go into work and look at that face.
You've got the best job in the whole world.
I have, I tell you.
if you love what you do and you get to do it at a high level, you can't really ask for much more.
Yeah, well, I mean, you know, for a long time I was a composer and it felt like you're in orbit. It felt lonely. And in the cutting room, I just feel in the middle of all of it. And it's a sort of a wonderful thing. You know, as a composer, I could sometimes go 3 or 4 days. The director didn't call for 4 or 5 days. Mm-hmm. And you'd just be a paranoid wreck, you know. Whereas 4 or 5 days without talking to a composer in the cutting room is no big thing because there's just, like, lots going on.
Right.
You're still point of the turning world. And I don't know. No, I love my job, as you can probably tell.
Excellent. Thank you so much for your time.
Yeah, nice one. Thank
Appreciate
you.
Appreciate it.
Thank you.